Soil background is an important factor to consider when conducting human health and ecological risk assessments. Regulators use numerical screening values specific to contaminants commonly found in soil to evaluate potential risks to people and the environment. For some chemicals, the screening value may be within the range of concentrations found in soils from natural or anthropogenic ambient background. Regulatory agencies typically do not require action to be taken if the amount of a chemical in soil is within the range of background concentrations. Thus, soil background plays an important role in remedial decisions. A well-designed sampling and analytical program is critical when establishing default or site-specific soil background or obtaining soil samples from a site to compare to background. This is video 2 supporting the ITRC Soil Background and Risk Guidance document and provides a brief overview of important components to consider when designing a soil background sampling program. These include choosing a background reference area, which discusses characteristics to be considered when choosing background locations, sampling programs, which discusses sample collection methods, design, and handling, and analytical methods, which discusses sample preparation and instrumental analyses. Soil background reference areas are the areas identified as appropriate for collection of samples used to ultimately determine a soil background concentration or range of concentrations. Choosing the background reference area starts with the conceptual site model, referred to as a CSM. The CSM provides the site context, including land use, geochemical and chemical considerations, and a basis for selecting background reference areas that reflect similar inputs minus site release impacts. Background sampling needs to be conducted at a location that is similar in many ways to the site that is being assessed. Compare the physical, chemical, geological, biological, and ecological characteristics of the background locations with the site. When choosing a background location, it is important to consider how the land is being used at both the background location and the site being investigated. The background location should not be affected by contaminants from any past or present releases or activities being investigated at the site. To avoid this possibility, choose a background location that is upgradient and/or upwind of the investigation site. Preferably, background locations are off-site. However, this may not be possible in large industrialized areas. In these instances, choose locations that are not obviously affected by site releases or activities caused by past or ongoing activities. Typically, when collecting background samples, make sure the samples are collected in native materials and not in fill material. If fill is a particular important consideration in your background study, contact your regulatory agency. When choosing a background location, avoid areas adjacent to roadways, drainage and stormwater ditches, and areas adjacent to industrial activity. These types of areas likely have accumulated contamination from other locations. It's a good idea to research possible background locations before choosing the best one. Knowledge of past and present activities at and around areas surrounding the site and potential background areas will help you with your final decision. For instance, conduct interviews with workers around the area to see what they know. Historical aerial photographs often show buildings that are no longer present and provide clues to past activities. Other helpful resources include geological maps, vegetation maps, soil maps, and similar items. You may be able to compare your chosen locations with databases of soil concentrations that are already available. Examples of these types of databases are US EPA's Cleanups in My Community and California's CalEnviro Screen. Research to see if your chosen background location is part of a database or close to a site in that database. When documenting your findings, it is important to include a clear and detailed description of the reasons for choosing background locations. The reasons need to be based on technically sound comparisons of the sample locations. If there are already suitable existing background data from areas located adjacent to the site being investigated, then evaluate if those data can be used as representative background values. For example, were the samples collected in a similar manner? Do the analytical methods that were used provide substantively equivalent results? Were other characteristics such as geological, biological, and chemical similar for the existing background study and the subject study? When choosing locations for natural background samples, it is important to choose areas that are not likely to have been impacted by human activities. As with any background location, natural background areas should have similar physical, geological, and biological characteristics. Locations that most likely meet these criteria are local public lands, such as state and national forests. If your goal is collecting anthropogenic ambient background soil samples, the same rule applies. Ensure similarities in physical, chemical, geological, and biological characteristics. These locations need to be in areas that have not been impacted by local releases, but may have detections of chemicals at low concentrations. Examples of chemicals that apply here are PAHs, PCBs, dioxins, and mercury. These can be persistent and ubiquitous and can be transported long distances with wind or water. It's important to remember that naturally occurring elements detected in soils are in part derived from chemically and/or physically weathered rocks. So geological characteristics should also be considered. It is possible that some of these naturally occurring elements are the same as the chemicals of potential concern at the investigation site. Examples include iron, manganese, arsenic, chlorides, fluorides, and sulfates. There are also other factors to consider. For instance, grain size distribution can contribute to environmental availability of naturally occurring elements. Another factor is soil texture, which can affect the distribution of contaminants of potential concern. For example, fine-grained soils typically have a greater sorption capacity for contaminants such as SVOCs and metals. And lastly, vegetation, which can also affect the distribution of some elements. Metals such as arsenic, lead, mercury, copper, and cadmium can be taken up by plants and/or absorbed to organic matter and concentrated in the surface soils when the plant dies. For more information on background reference areas, see Section 9 of the ITRC Soil Background and Risk Assessment Guidance.
Let's move on to important considerations when designing a soil background sampling program. A well-designed sampling program is critical when conducting a study to determine soil background or to obtaining soil samples to compare to soil background. Sampling for developing representative background comparison concentrations can be accomplished by collecting discrete samples, composite samples, or using an incremental sampling methodology referred to as ISM. Each method has its advantages and disadvantages. It is important, however, that soil background samples be collected using the same or similar sampling methods as the samples from the site that is being evaluated to ensure comparability of the datasets. Discrete soil sampling is the collection of a single soil sample from a specific location and depth interval. Discrete samples can provide an understanding of the distribution of concentrations in an area and help identify localized areas of elevated concentrations. A large number of samples relative to other sampling methods, however, may be needed to adequately characterize an area. A composite soil sample is a sample composed of multiple smaller samples that are physically mixed to create a single sample. A single composite sample can be more representative of a defined area than a single discrete sample. Composite sampling, however, reduces the amount of information on variability in soils in the area and can mask or dilute information on spatial trends. ISM is a structured sampling and processing protocol for collecting numerous increments of soil from a defined area that are then combined, processed, and subsampled for laboratory analysis. ISM can provide more consistent and reproducible results when characterizing the mean than obtained by discrete or composite sampling approaches. ISM, however, represents a physical average, and a background threshold value calculated from the data will likely not be representative of the upper tail of the background data distribution. See ITRC's Incremental Sampling Methodology Update, ISM2, at ism-2.itrcweb.org for more information on incremental sampling. In designing your investigation, it is important to consider the cost-benefit of different sampling approaches. And as part of that, to determine which methods will also work well for background areas. Sampling programs using multiple approaches can be used for complex sites. However, it is important to match the method for the background samples to the comparison site samples. The number of samples should be based on the selected sampling approach and consider the variables such as the size of the background reference area, use of the data, assumptions about the distribution of concentrations in soil, acceptable error rate, and expected variability. Software such as Visual Sample Plan and EPA's ProUCL are available to evaluate the number of samples required for various statistics and statistical comparisons. These include estimations of the mean, as well as one sample and two sample hypothesis tests. Target sample depth can vary based on various factors: the potential for leaching or volatilization of chemicals of potential concern in soil, geologic factors including soil type, depth to groundwater, and depth to bedrock or fill, and for risk assessment, the soil sample depths should be chosen based on the depths that human and ecological receptors are expected to have contact with the soil. The volume of soil collected will be dependent on sampling program requirements, such as ISM, the requirements of the analytical method selected, and the sample collection method used, and the laboratory quality control or field requirements. Surface and shallow soil sample collection typically uses hand-push probes or augers. These tools generally cause minimal site disturbance and are low cost. Test pits are commonly used to collect shallow to intermediate soil samples. Samples are collected from the bucket of excavation equipment, such as a backhoe, which requires a high level of soil disturbance and a moderate cost. Drilling is used to collect shallow to deep soil samples. Samples can be collected in all types of geologic material, which requires a moderate level of site disturbance and higher costs. Samples should be stored in containers, preserved as required by the analytical method, collected with clean tools and equipment decontaminated between each sample, and handled with appropriate precautions to avoid cross-contamination between samples. Sampling protocols are especially critical for low-level constituents where cross-contamination may result in false positives. Some analytes, such as PFAS, may require specific precautions to avoid sample contamination. As mentioned previously, it is important that background samples be collected using the same methods as the comparison site samples. In some cases, differing conditions, such as presence of fill or pavement in only the study area or in only the site, may warrant alternative sampling methods. However, a method should be selected that best represents the method used on the comparison site. For more information on sampling for soil background, see Section 9 of the ITRC Soil Background and Risk Assessment Guidance. A critical component in establishing soil background is to ensure that the soil samples are analyzed by laboratory methods that generate high-quality analytical data that are comparable to the site data being evaluated. If possible, use the same lab for both the background site and the subject site. Verify that the lab has third-party accreditation or certification in the methods and analytes required. Involve the lab early in preparation of the QAP to ensure that data quality objectives are identified and can be met. Reported soil sample contaminant concentrations can be influenced by soil sample collection and preservation methods, laboratory sample preparation methods, and the laboratory analytical methods. Project data quality objectives focus on precision, accuracy, reproducibility, and sensitivity. For most projects, sensitivity, that is, the ability of the lab to reliably report concentrations low enough to meet project needs, is the most critical data quality objective. Sensitivity can be especially important in background samples, which may have lower concentrations than site samples. A large percentage of non-detects in a background data set may not support important evaluations, such as the derivation of background threshold values. Analytical test methods used in the background study should provide substantively equivalent results to the laboratory method used at the investigative site or sites being evaluated. It is important not to mix and match methods by using a different approach for background. Examples include using USGS versus US EPA metal test methods which use different acids for digestion, or using field screening results and laboratory results in the same data set, or in the two data sets that are being compared. Data validation is conducted to assess data quality and trace the history of the sample from collection through sample storage, sample preparation, instrumental analysis, and data reduction. Data validation ensures that the resulting data from the sample's analysis are accurate, traceable, and appropriately qualified to support site decisions. Ultimately, data validation provides an assessment as to whether and how usable the data are for site decision-making. Typical usability issues include sensitivity, or whether the analytical method reporting limits are low enough to detect a target analyte, the ability to identify target analytes of concern in soil samples, for example, peak resolution, and poor recoveries and other quantitation reliability issues. For more information on analytical methods for soil background, see Section 10 of the ITRC Soil Background and Risk Assessment document at itrcweb.org.
The Interstate Technology and Regulatory Council is a nonprofit research program of the Environmental Council of the States. ITRC is a state-led organization composed of over 1,000 members from state agencies, federal government, tribal and international organizations, the private sector, academia, and community stakeholders. Members participate in technical teams which produce guidance, tools, resources, and training materials. If you'd like to be a part of ITRC, please visit the ITRC website at itrcweb.org. You can register for teams and learn more about how you can be an active member. ITRC's usage policy is available on the ITRC website. If you do plan to use ITRC materials, we ask that you review that policy in detail and be sure to credit ITRC. ITRC does not warranty the material nor endorse any specific products.